Good morning, everybody, and welcome back for another seminar in the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía in Granada, in Spain. And today we will have the talk by Dr. Giacomo Bonoli.
I will start recording now.
I'm stuck. I cannot listen.
And he will talk about the ASTRI mini array and its science. So a brief introduction of Dr. Bonoli is that after his graduation in physics at the Pisa University, he joined the MAGIC group in the University of Siena for his PhD in experimental physics, entering the world of ground-based gamma ray astronomy in the very high energy band with the imaging atmospheric Cherenkov telescope. His PhD thesis dealt with the simultaneous multi-wavelength observational studies of blazars, aiming to constrain emission models for these fascinating sources. This work continued for 7 years at Brera Observatory in Milan, where he also joined the Cherenkov Telescope Array and mostly the ASTRI collaboration, where he took the responsibility for design and validation of the coating of the elements of the optical chain of ASTRI SST2M prototype, the Italian prototype for a small size telescope for CTA based on the Schwarzschild Coudé optical configuration. Back in University of Siena for almost 5 years since the beginning of 2016 as a fixed term researcher with teaching duties, and afterward research contractor between 19 and 20. Since August 18 and until March 2022, he was appointed as convener for the Extragalactic Physics Working Group within the MAGIC collaboration. In November 2020, he was incorporated at our institute here in Granada as a Severo Ochoa postdoc within the CTA group led by Ivan Agudo, cooperating in the field of Cherenkov, which is MAGIC CTA large size telescopes, and also taking care of program of optical photometry and polarimetry of blazars with the telescope of the Sierra Nevada Observatory and the 2.2 meter in Calaralto. Since December 2021, he's a staff researcher in Brera Astronomical Observatory, an institute belonging to INAF, the Italian National Institute for Astrophysics. Among main estrate, Giacomo cultivates blazars and blazar models, variability studies in blazars, relationship to ultra-high energy cosmic ray. Also, he's interested in blazar-related themes in cosmology and fundamental physics, such as studies for the topics of the intergalactic magnetic fields and of Lorentz invariance violations that can be based on blazars observation at teravolt energies. He keeps on working in the field of imaging atmospheric Cherenkov telescopes and optical observations of blazars, especially about this last topic, he will work in close collaboration with the IAEA group led by Ivan Agudo. So thank you very much, Giacomo, for accepting this invitation, for being here at the Institute, and the floor is yours.
Thanks a lot, René. Thanks for the introduction. Thanks for the invitation. I'm glad to be here again, giving a talk in presence this time, and to meet this institute that I learned to be an institute of very good scientists and very good friends. And so I will talk about the ASTRI mini array and its science on behalf of the ASTRI project. So the ASTRI mini array is a project whose purpose is to construct, deploy, and operate an array of 9 Cherenkov telescopes of the 4-meter class at the Observatorio del Teide in Tenerife, in collaboration with ISE. There is an effort of more than 150 researchers belonging to Italian National Institute for Astrophysics Institutes from different observatories across whole Italy, Italian University, also in connection with INFN, Italian National Institute for Nuclear Physics Institute, the Fundación Galileo Galilei and Canary Islands, and other international institutions, the Instituto de Astrofisica de Canarias, the University of São Paulo in Brazil, the Northwest University in South Africa, and the University in Observatoire de Genève in Switzerland. Also, there is a strong contribution and integration with the Italian and foreign industrial companies that are involved in the project with important industrial returns. So just a sketch of the organization of the project, which is quite structured. You can see on the right the principal investigator, Giovanni Pareschi. Then we have a project manager, project scientist, system engineer, user group coordinator, and leader of the scientific software development that belong mostly to ENAF institutes. And there is a structure that comprises a project office and this project office is steering more or less a wealth of system work packages and science program work packages. And you can see here the work breakdown structure for the Astri Mini Array with the different work packages related to different subjects, including science. So Astri comes from the, actually something that I will not touch. So the a technique for building the mirrors, because it's astrophysics with Italian replicating technology mirrors. So it's a technique for building cheap mirrors for Cherenkov astronomy based on the standard industrial glass, more or less, by replicating the mirrors with some aluminum honeycomb, and glued on the aluminum honeycomb, there are hexagons of glass, one on the back, one on the front one is coated, and everything is bound on a mold to give the desired curvature for the mirrors. This is an Italian let's say patent of many years ago, started already for production of magic mirrors. So it's astrophysics with Italian replicating technology mirrors and astrofisica a specchi con tecnologia replicante italiana in Italian. That's why Astri. And so the first effort was this project funded by Ministry of Research to build a prototype that was later entitled HORN to acknowledge the important pioneering work of Guido Horn d'Arturo, who was the inventor of the technique of producing tessellated mirrors. Now it's very widespread, but this was something that was made by an idea by a single man, and this telescope was named after him a few years ago. And so this is an end-to-end prototype, which is installed and operational on Mount Etna in Sicily. And the accomplishments were quite outstanding because it gave the first detection of a gamma ray source with the dual mirror Cherenkov telescope based on this quadricode configuration. Also, to validate the telescope, there was an observation with an optical camera of Polaris, which, to my knowledge, is the first published observation of such a Schwarzschild-Cuder telescope of a star. And then the second step is this array of 9 Astri telescopes, so working in stereoscopy. And this is made with this collaboration extended to some international institutions. And this is being deployed at the Observatory of Teide and will work for 4 years, initially producing observatory science, so related to the experiment, and then it will open to some observatory science accepting proposals from outside. And so just to mention these results, you can see this is the Polaris star imaged with the optical camera in the beginning of the Astri Horn prototype operations in Sicily. And you can see a remarkable feature that the star is imaged with a almost constant PSF at different distance. So this is on the field of view on the far left, at the center of the field of view, and then tilting the observation by 1.5 degrees, 3 degrees, 4.5 degrees, because the field of view of the telescope is quite wide for Cherenkov telescopes, and most of all is quite unaberrated with constant PSF. Optical astronomers may be disturbed by the quality of this image of Polaris, but you must learn that in Cherenkov we want to have very huge reflectors that have to be outside, they don't have a dome, and we don't have very strict requests for the optical quality. So a point spread function or a few arc minutes for us is enough. And that's why we can build mirrors that cost of the order of 1,000, 2,000 euros for a square meter. This is in optical astronomy is insane. It's much more, the quality requested is much higher and the cost is much more. And then there was the Cherenkov camera, and this is in order of 12 hours, the observation of the excess in a region that is close to the position on the sky of the source. Here you can see the background counts in gray, and up you see on the left of the plot that there are some excess counts that are excess gamma ray events detected for the Crab Nebula. And this again was a very first, because it was the first Cherenkov telescope of this optical configuration with two mirrors in a Schwarzschild configuration to make this observation. So the Astri Mini Array will go in Tenerife, and there will be the telescope array, a local control room that is hosted at the Themis Observatory, at the Themis Telescope Building in Teide. Then there will be at the Teide Residencia an on-site data center, and then there will be a Array Operation Center office in warehouses at ISA in La Laguna. And then there will be a main data center in Rome and array operation centers at the involved in a few institute that you can see in the right picture. So just for the non-Cherenkov guys, how Cherenkov detection of very high energy gamma rays above some tens of giga electron volts works. So Cherenkov effect gives light flashes in the optical blue and ultraviolet band that come from charged particles. In our case, it will be electrons and positrons that are superluminal in a transparent medium. So in the atmosphere, the speed of the light is not equal to the one in the vacuum, because the refractive index of the atmosphere is one plus some a little fraction of like 3 × 10⁻⁴. And so you can have that there is no violation of fundamental physics if an electron is faster than a photon in this medium. So we want to detect at the scale of a few nanoseconds, because this Cherenkov flashes from the gamma rays impinging on the Earth atmosphere are very, very clustered in time. We want to see these optical UV flashes from the extended ray showers that are generated by these very high energy gamma rays that enter Earth's atmosphere. The gamma ray impacts with some particle in the atmosphere, and then it starts to produce couples of electrons and positrons, and by hyperproduction and by Bressstrahlung effect, the energetic leptons produce other photons. So there is a cascade where there are generations of particles that are produced, and the number of particles until some point grows, the average energy falls down, and as long as leptons, light leptons have of the order of 20 MeV of energy, they remain superluminal and produce this Cherenkov flash that is very clustered along the direction of travel of the electron or positron. So we can detect the Cherenkov images of the extended air shower. So it's a double indirect detection. We have the primary gamma ray, we have the shower of particles, and we detect the light that the shower of particles produces by Cherenkov effect. And we can reconstruct these shower images. And so we can at first recognize if the primary is a cosmic ray, so a charged particle, where we cannot reconstruct the direction to the source, because they are deflected in the cosmic magnetic field from the photons, and we are interested in photons to make astronomy of individual sources. Then we can reconstruct the arrival direction and make a map, And then we can reconstruct the energy of the primary gamma ray. As a basic picture, the more is the energy of the primary, the higher is the amount of light that is produced in the image. This is parameterized by other topic features like the zenith distance, so the elevation of the observation and others. So you have to think not only of the telescope, but of the telescope plus the atmosphere above the telescope as a giant calorimeter and tracker. And what makes this kind of telescope competitive against, for instance, satellites is that it has a huge effective area and the atmosphere is light, but is very thick. So you can measure fully the energy of very high energy particles. For instance, the Fermi satellite can image the direction of TV photons, but not all the energy is measured in the satellite because the products of the interaction are so energetic that they pierce through the satellite. In the atmosphere, we have radiation lengths of thickness. And these are important features for going up in energy and for detecting very faint fluxes. All the spectra of non-thermal sources have more or less vanishing power law spectra, maybe with cutoffs. So the higher you go in energy, the least is the flux of photon you detect. When you have more than one telescope, you can image the same shower from different direction and make a stereoscopic reconstruction. And all the features, so the angular resolution, the energy resolution, and the discriminating power of the background of cosmic rays are improved. So this is just a movie from the MAGIC collaboration of the detection of an event. So you have a primary gamma ray, it makes the extended air shower of particles, the superluminar charged leptons produce this blue ultraviolet flash. And if the telescopes are comprised into the imprint on the ground of the shower, they can detect the light. This lasts a few nanoseconds, actually. So the idea is, in this sketch is that you have this narrow cone where Cherenkov is produced, and on the focal plane, if you run fast enough, that's why we use the photomultipliers and now silicon photomultipliers, you can see this self-elliptical image, which is the parallaxed image of the shower. And from the analysis, you reject the background of cosmic rays, you reconstruct the energy in the direction with the collection area of 10 to the 5 square meter around, resolution with 20%. If you have two eyes, then you can make this 3D reconstruction by intersecting the different images of the two eyes that look at the same event, and you have improved performance. So, for instance, for the energy, you measure the integrated light that you find in the image, and for the direction in the sky, you have a major axis of this pseudo-elliptical reconstruction, you merge the fields of view, and then you have in the middle that at the crossing of the major axis, more or less is the position of the source of that individual photon in the sky. When you merge the planes where each telescope detects the axis on the ground, you see on the bottom right that you can pinpoint the impact parameter of photons. So the distance on the ground between the projection of the axis of the shower and each of the telescope that compose the array. This is a very important point. This is on the right, you have for a simulation of gamma rays of different energy. With the increasing energy, you have that the line of black points goes up. This is the density of photons per square meter that are produced by Cherenkov light on the ground. And you can see that there is a more or less flat part until 100 meters from the telescope. You have that more or less all the showers of a given energy produce the same density of photons on the ground. And then when distance grows, there is a vanishing tail. So an important feature is that you have a wide field of view. You may image photons that are arriving at, with impact parameters or distances that are far beyond this magic number of 120 meters where there is the start of the dropping tail. And if you have a wide field of view with an aberrated field and contact PSF, the effective area of each telescope can grow a lot, and you can put the telescope at huge distances. To make a comparison, the magic telescopes work in the so-called poor area, pool area, so where this distribution is flat, and so they are at 85 meters one from the other. We will space the ASTRI mini array telescopes by 200 meters more or less, and because we want to cover a wide area, and so to increase our effective area for very faint fluxes at the in the TEV region. This is here, you can see that if you reconstruct not very well, so with some uncertainty, the impact parameters, so the distance between the telescope and the axis of the travel direction of the gamma ray, you may have some important uncertainty on the energy that you reconstruct. If you have this level of light, then if you move from the left to the right yellow line, you reconstruct a different energy. So if you want to have a good energy resolution, you must be very precise in determining the impact parameter of the showers. And that's the idea of the wide field technique that ASTRI mini array will try to implement. So this is the ASTRI Horn prototype in Sicily at Serra Lanaga Observatory. And then there was an evolution. You can see that the structure is of the order of 30% lighter with some important, this is the support of the secondary mirror, and it is quite changed in the ASTRI 1 telescope that is already installed in the observatory. So there was some kind of evolution. The structure of the telescope is as such. You have the primary mirror, you have a secondary mirror, and the camera is here hidden. Maybe you can see it better. It's very close to the secondary mirror looking at it. So it's trapped inside. Why? Because in this way, we can have a highly demagnified field. So we image a huge field of view over a short plate scale, and we can have a 50 by 50 centimeter camera that images at 10 degrees wide field of view. And if you look at the middle panel, you can see that the measured PSF, so the light, the radius that they comprises 80% of the light from a source, is more or less constant across the whole field of view. And this is one of the most important points of this optical configuration with PSF that is quite constant across the field of view and an aberrated field. So this is a sketch, the camera. These are the units of silicon photomultipliers that are grouped in a matrix of 8 by 8 pixels. Each pixel is 7 by 7 millimeters, and they cover this curved focal surface, which is the Coudé part of the optical configuration. It's varsity Coudé because you have these two mirrors, the camera looking at the secondary mirror, and Coudé added this curved focal surface. Another important point that you will see later on is that for silicon PM, there is the problem that the night sky background, which is quite dominant in the red, while the Cherenkov spectrum is concentrated in the blue, must be rejected somehow. And so it was designed a cover that has an interferential filter that is rejecting the red part of the spectrum. Again, picture of the camera. So you have this front-end electronics that is based on a CityRock ASIC, silicon PM sensor. We will have more than 2000 pixels. There are 37 matrices, and the complete field of view is tend to, in the diameter, 10.5 degrees, and the angular peak size is 0.2 degrees. This looks very coarse, but we are not interested in point sources, but we are interested in extended images that are produced at 10 kilometers, more or less, above our head within the atmosphere. That's why we don't have high requests on the, for instance, on the resolution. And this is the filter window that I was mentioning before. These are the how the cameras for the ASTRI Mini Array will look like. Again, an evolution of the camera for ASTRIOR. So if we go to the sensitivity of the system, you can see that here we are in TV, 1 TV, 10, 100 TV. This mini array will have a sensitivity that extends to order of a few hundreds of gigaelectron volt, and down to 10 to minus 12 erg per square centimeter per second. And is in the part above a few TVs, it will overcome the sensitivity of current arrays like Hess or Magic and Veritas. And so, and it will extend naturally to the domain of 100 TVs. So we can, for instance, extend the spectra of already detected TV sources or measure cutoffs in the region of the several TVs. Another important point is that the energy resolution, if you look, for instance, to the red point, to the red points in the top panel, the different lines are for different off-axis positions. In the resolution is a very good of the order of better than 15%. While the angular resolution will be of the order of 3 arc minutes at 10 TeV. And this will make possible combining these things to make a very precise spectra and to detect morphology of extended sources. I will show some examples. An important point is that the performance is very stable, even far off axis. If you compare the blue line, which is the Magic that has a shorter cameras and a smaller field of view cameras of 3.5 degrees in diameter and a different optical configuration because a parabolic mirror, you can see that our performance will be quite stable up to a few degrees from the center. And so this is very ideal when you want to image a very extended source or a crowded field, because especially on the galactic plane, there are crowded fields. And this is a plot of the differential sensitivity compared to current and to future like CTA instruments. On the right, you have also the LASO observatory, which is a different kind of observatory for this more or less the same energy that detects directly the particle showers, not the Cherenkov light, at least at this moment. And these are the important figures compared between the ASTRI Mini Array, where you see this angular resolution, this energy resolution, and the energy range extending at 200 TeVs compared to Magic Veritas and Hess, so the current Cherenkov arrays, and to particle sampling detectors like Hawk, LASO, or Tibet AS Gamma. Recently, we published 4 papers on Journal of High Energy Astrophysics and describing the ASTRI Mini Array, its core science, and some deeper and wider scientific cases in the fields of galactic and extragalactic sources. But we can think about main topics, so related to the origin of cosmic rays, so studying pevatrons, cosmic ray acceleration and propagation, and pulsar wind nebulae and terra electron volt halos. Topics in fundamental physics, like studying the intergalactic magnetic fields, blazars, and from blazar, for instance, the possibility of detecting axion-like particles or violations of the Lorentz invariance, and the study of transients. The concept is of pillars. So in the first 4 years, there will be specific science topics profiting at best of this very wide field of view that allows also to study multiple sources in a single observations. And the pillars that have been individuated are pillar one on the origin of cosmic rays, so studying perathrons, propagation, and pulsar wind nebulae, and ultra-energy cosmic ray, for instance, from starburst galaxies, and pillar two on fundamental physics, like cosmology topics, like measuring the extragalactic background light in the infrared, or probably in intergalactic magnetic fields, studying if there are hadrons launched by blazars, and Lorentz invariance violation, and new particles. So basically, pillar one is based on galactic sources. Pillar two is based on extragalactic sources. Of course, this list of sources reflect the science knowledge at the time of writing this paper. So over time, this list might be improved according to new findings that are flourishing continuously. So a touch on the this is the very interesting list of 12 sources detected by LASO on the galactic plane that are emitting up to petaelectron volts energies, so 1,000 of teraelectron volts, and the only identified for sure is CRAB, but also for CRAB there is the problem that the mechanism of production is not well constrained. It might be leptonic, might be hadronic, and so on. And most of the sources are extended sources, and the actual sources have not yet been firmly localized and identified, let alone the emission process. So AstriMini Array will investigate these and future ultra-energy sources, providing both the opportunity for precise identification and information also on the morphology of the extended source. So for instance, this is an interesting source by LASO. You see quite huge PSF of LASO, the spectrum from 10 to order of few hundreds of TV. But if you look in other bands, like in the radio bands, you see that these sorts may correspond to very different sources, and you need to be to get a better angular resolution. And this is a simulation, for instance, of the ASTRI performance within the field of the Hawke error box. And you can see that in 200 hours of simulations and up to the order of 200 TeV, this region can be somehow studied in the sense of understanding its morphology. This is instead the signal region where you have a crowded field of many different point sources that can be studied at once. So in this case, as long as this spectral energy distribution is considered, you can see that ASTRI may extend the performance of current imaging atmospheric Cherenkov with a deep exposure on the tail at high energies around 100 TeVs for this source, allowing also to maybe detect cutoffs. And if we move back to the LASO source, you can see that you can have here the gray and the yellow lines that correspond to different models, one leptonic and one hadronic. And you see on the right table that different models with one zone, with two components, with leptons and hadrons, or leptons and hadrons together, can still be compatible with current data. And in the bottom view, you can see that an energy dependent morphology, so with the one region in the map that is emitting at low energy and another region in the map that is emitting at high energy, can be resolved by the ASTRI observation. And here there is a little movie where you can see in the top the sky map that evolves from the bottom to the top region. And in the bottom, you have that different components can be observed by the ASTRI mini array that has a energy threshold, so the lower edge of the energy band that is well below the one of LASS. Other sources may be like Gamma Cygni, middle age supernova remnant in the signal season discovered by Veritas. And if you see in the plot, there are two different models, A and B, that are determined with different tails in the right part of the plot at the highest energies. And the ASTRI mini-array, the simulation, can disentangle the two behaviors. And so, for instance, it can constrain physical parameters such as the maximum energy reached by protons and their diffusion coefficient, and on top of that investigate the morphology, because this is another extended source. Similar studies can be done with other middle-age supernova remnants. Also, the CRAB is an important topic because LASO do not require in the data a hadronic contribution, but cannot exclude it. And so you can see that for different values of this proton contribution to the luminosity and different Lorentz factor of the protons, you have different tails in the very high energies above 100 TeV that are compatible with all compatible with current data. And with a deep exposure of order of 500 hours, the ASTRI mini array can disentangle these different models assumed in the simulation. Another very important point is the very wide, a few degrees in diameter, TV halos around the pulsar wind nebula that, for instance, Hawk detects. And with the contribution of the energy band extended to hundreds of TV, of the good angular resolution and the good energy resolution, these regions can be an ideal case for ASTRI, and also the profile, the energy dependent profile moving away from the center, from the position of the pulsar wind nebula, can be studied. For pillar two, some examples. So there is this opacity in gamma rays related to the presence of extragalactic background light. The component made by stars in the optical is quite well constrained, but there is the reprocessing by dust in the infrared that is not well constrained. And the direct measurement are a bit obstructed by the presence of important foregrounds. So we can study the attenuation of fluxes of TV sources to measure the density and its evolution with Z of the light. And the higher you go in energy, the farther you go in the infrared. So at 10 TV, you explore the region of 12 microns. And if you observe sources that are enough nearby, this is the blazar IC310, which is in the Perseus, so Z is 0.02 or a bit less, you see that the attenuation becomes too much for any reasonable detection at the order of 20-30 TVs. And with our band, this is the sensitivity of ASTRI, we can explore such sources, make long integration, and measure indirectly the density of the extragalactic background light by its attenuation. Another important topic is that the relativistic jets in extreme VLAX can be a part of one of the acceleration sets of ultra-high energy cosmic rays. And so they could produce hadron beams that are collimated beams of high energy nuclei or protons. And that traveling towards the Earth, they can lose energy through pair production and photomeson processes, and they can also produce neutrinos, maybe detected by IceCube. It's a topic for multi-messenger studies. And they can trigger the development of electromagnetic cascades, producing also gamma rays. So if the gamma ray is not produced in the source, but is midway, the attenuation is less. And this may produce this red tail in the plot, which is at higher energies because the cyan line is simulation with the standard leptonic jets, and then with the hadron beam you produce a spectrum that extends farther away, and a streaming array can disentangle, can discriminate these two situations in observations of the order of 200 hours of integration. Another important topic is that now we know that gamma ray bursts are TV sources, because in 2019 MAGIC detected one up to something around 1 TV. And then a few weeks ago, LASO detected a super bright, super nearby gamma ray burst extending at least at 10 TV in energy. So we can also have hopes to these are simulation for an observation starting 200 seconds after a GRB that is of the similar to the one that MAGIC observed in 2019 and lasts for 600 seconds, putting this GRB at different distances in Z. And you can see that even for Z of 0.4, the ASTRI mini array can make a detection of GRBs in the TV region. And the number of alerts is of the order of one per month, the number of useful alerts that are in the night without clouds, without with the source observable in the sky. And so this is another important topic for the ASTRI mini array. So synergies, ASTRI mini array will not work alone, because MAGIC and the CTA Observatory of the Northern Site will be of paramount importance for their capability to investigate not only the local universe, but also for reaching redshift beyond one. This is maybe a bit too much for the ASTRI mini array, but there is a logic of complementarity between these different Cherenkov observatory. And also this other observatory with a huge telescope up to 23 meters, and so a lower energy threshold, will allow to extend the ASTRI mini array spectral performance down to tens of GV, so far below what ASTRI can the minimal energy that ASTRI can detect, and with almost no break over a few decades in energy. And then there are interactions with the particle sampling arrays like LASO, like Hawk, and for instance, their catalogs comprise several sources with photons in the regime of several hundred TVs. And ASTRI can interact with them, profiting from the better energy resolution and the better angular resolution. Then there is a much wider multi-wavelength landscape that goes from radio observatories to optical observatories to satellites for X-rays, including now not only photometry, imaging, spectroscopy, but also polarimetry since the flight of the XPE satellite. And then the gamma rays observatory and other instruments like SWIFT in the future as SVOM that have important sentinels, for instance, for GRBs and so on. So a note on the implementation of the project. So the hosting agreement at the Osteri Observatory with the Instituto di Astrofisica de Canarias foresees 4+4 years of operation for the ASTRI mini array starting from the beginning. So during the first years, there will be an experimental-like, so closed environment for the operations. And during this time, the ASTRI science team will develop a strategy to concentrate the observational time on a limited number of programs with clearly identified scientific project. That's why the simulations are performed with hundreds of hours of integration, because this will be the philosophy of our science, core science. After the initial period, the project will gradually move towards observatory model, in which a fraction of the time will be assigned to scientific proposal through a time allocation committee procedure, as usual in many observatory. So there will be no real-time analysis of the data, but the data along the observation will be checked for quality, and the data analysis policies will be the next day processing. So the triggers, because you need to image an event with multiple telescopes, you want to find a temporal coincidence of the image in one telescope and the image in the other telescope. This coincidence triggers will be implemented offline at the software level, so connecting the timestamps of the events in the different the acquisitions of the different telescopes, and it will be performed at the ASTRI data center in Rome. The number of observational modes will be limited, so there will be normal integrational mode, for instance, integrating on a steady source as long as it's possible. Target of opportunity mode for transient on blazars, GRBs, for instance. Coordinated mode, that means that we want to observe together at the same time sources simultaneously, for instance, with MAGIC or with CTA, or maybe with the TNG telescope, Galileo telescope in La Palma. The night science operation will be controlled remotely from the data center in La Laguna, so no people is required at the site during the night. There will be this local control room at the Themis Observatory that will be used in the early phases during commissioning, science verification phase, and during the maintenance activities or in case of special activities. And there will be other array operation center, other control room across Italy, because the system will be controlled remotely. A bit of timeline. So we have already in the site one telescope, ASTRI-1. And then we'll go towards phase one with the three telescope structure, hopefully completed in late spring 2023. Then with integrating with the cameras, it will start early observation to verify the system. And then there will be the deployment of the full array. And so in early 2025, we hope to have 9 telescopes that can be operated and start the operations. Now, a few pictures. So we have the structure and with the dish support of the ASTRI-1 deployed on its basement in Teide Observatory. These are other pictures with the mirror, the tiles of the primary mirror integrated. Here you have a beautiful night sight of the galactic plane and other pictures. Now with the secondary mirror, you can see, and this is the support of the camera. And just to give a summary, the mini array will start scientific observations in the first quarter of 2025 from the Observatory of Teide, with a program encompassing 4 years for the core science and 4 years of observatory science. Its 10 degree field of view will allow to investigate both extended sources and crowded rich fields with a single pointing. And the 3 arc-minutes angular resolution at 10 TV will allow us to perform detailed morphological studies of the extended sources. The sensitivity extending above 100 TV will make it the most sensitive Cherenkov telescope in the energy range of from 5 to 100 TVs in the northern hemisphere, and will join together the very high energy domain typical of particle sampling arrays with the precision domain, excellent angular and energy resolution typical of Cherenkov telescopes. So you can find more at this website. The 4 papers that I mentioned are at this have these coordinates, bibliometric coordinates. We are also present on socials on Facebook and Instagram with Astri Gamma. And if you want to play with the instrument response functions that are compatible with Gamma Pi and C tools, you can find them at this web link. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Giacomo, for this talk. And now the talk is open for questions. So if there are any questions on the room, please raise your hand. Maybe Francisco can manage, or yourself, Giacomo. And I will tell you if there is a question here in Zoom.
I saw half of a hand by Ruben.
Yeah, I was. So I have a question regarding that. So you've shown the sensitivity of the Astri Mini Array compared to that of Lasso.
Yeah.
Right.
Ah, sorry, I forgot in that slide that this was, there was 50, there was 200, and there was 500. Okay. So they looked very nearby because it was assuming a very deep exposure. It was not the usual 50 in the one with Lasso. That's why maybe you were a bit puzzled.
No.
I can go back to it, however, so that everybody knows what we are discussing about.
That one is city, not 50 hours. Okay, but anyways, so Lasso is always gonna do better than the Astri Mini Array, but you guys have a much better energy resolution.
Yeah. Right?
So have you evaluated whether you would be able to distinguish cutoffs actually better than Lasso, even though you have a worse sensitivity in this energy range?
This is an interesting
15% energy resolution.
I would say that if the energy resolution is poor, you are usually lost. So if you integrate more, which is the case of Lasso that is working all the day, every day, and so on, at some point you are anyway confused by your poor energy resolution. But I don't have a figure to answer you now. Maybe that is somewhere, I don't have it to the talk, but we have this case of distinguish different cutoff positions for galactic sources.
Yeah, that would be interesting.
Ivan?
Yeah, also about those two graphs.
Yeah.
You are comparing sensitivity with regard to CTA north, but not with CTA south. I mean, it's clear that CTA south in the same energy range is going to be much more.
Yes, because they will have the south array will have a larger multiplicity of telescopes and will have a small size telescopes that are much similar to the Astri Mini Array telescope, because the current configuration is thought to have the Astri structure and to be compatible with the Czech camera, which is a different Cherenkov camera produced and developed by different institutes. With the 70, maybe, or 35 at least of those telescopes, the southern array will beat by multiplicity the Astri Mini Array. But we are observing different skies. And there might be cases of sources that are quite unique because they are maybe producers of cosmic rays and are very, 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 very nearby. And in this case, being in the north, it will be the better instrument to investigate this case. Also, there is a time lapse before the southern array is deployed, even in the best scenario, because there is a lot of work that has to be done regarding also the infrastructure, and it takes time. And so the Astri Mini Array will have some advantage in the timeline.
Yeah, that was going to be my question. But I have a second one, if I can. What about intensity interferometry? Are there plans to do?
Yes, it's being studied. And actually, unfortunately, I couldn't touch everything, but there are plans for intensity interferometry. This system, I didn't go into detail, but we don't have only the Cherenkov trigger, but we have a very nice system of studying the variance of the signal in the frames where there is no Cherenkov trigger. And so, for instance, we can check our positioning in the sky, because we can detect by the variance of the signal in the pixels the presence of higher night sky background. So we are sensitive also to stars, and this is something that we will use for make also intensity interferometry, which would be quite nice because we have 9 telescopes and they are very well spaced in a mostly not so regular way. So we'll be able to explore many different bases on this respect. So it's already been done, and this is a nice, let's say, parallel project. Ruben?
I wanted to know, what about the response to transit events? So do you guys have like any automatic system to reposition the telescope?
Okay, this is being discussed. In the beginning, I don't think it was planned, but now I think that after the LASO GRB, it's mandatory, because these GRBs, if are that bright and that nearby, which happens one over 50 years, if our log-n-log-s is correct. However, there are many intermediate cases when you can have a signal at 5 TVs, 7 TVs, 10 TVs, maybe even more, and we want to be able to react as fast as possible. Our simulation with nice detections, even nice spectra and recognition of cutoffs, were made assuming the GRB of MAGIC, the one of 2019, not only in brightness, but also in the decay. So we integrated from 200 seconds until 800 seconds, because we knew from the MAGIC results that you have at least 15 minutes, let's say, of signal in the gamma ray band. So this can be considered, I would say, also conservative.
I have a very naive question from someone that's outside the field.
Yeah.
So you mentioned at the beginning that the optical quality is not critical in these kind of telescopes, so you can use very cheap mirrors. So imagine that you could put the best mirrors ever in your telescope. Would that change somehow any of the performances?
So this is being discussed. There is a different structure to the telescope, which is the one being developed by American universities, led by Vladimir Vasiliev, who was actually the one who thought for the first to think about the Schwarzschild-Coudet telescope for Cherenkov. It has the same, more or less, the same Schwarzschild-Coudet configuration, but is of the medium size telescope class. So it's a 12 meter diameter class telescope. It's huge. And they went for quite strong requirements on the optical quality and on the camera pixelization. But still, what we are imaging are things that are degrees wide, and that by intrinsic features of the flashes, the magical number has to be of the order of 3 arc minutes. So if you compare to the few arc seconds that are needed to make any reasonable optical astronomy, we don't have such a requirement because of the extended image that we want to image. And then if you have very good quality mirrors, you must protect them. So you would need to double the cost to build the gigantic domes, more than double maybe. So it would be crazy.
Any question on Zoom participants? Please raise your hand. Seeing none, we can thank again Giacomo for this wonderful talk.
Thank you.
And we will wait you all tomorrow, that we have another seminar at the IAA. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.